In environmental geography, we studied different abiotic and biotic factors. In abiotic factors, lithospheric, atmospheric, and hydrospheric factors were there, and in biotic, plants and animals. After knowing the definition of environment, we studied about its relationship, means ecology and ecosystem in the environment, which studies the energy flow and biogeochemical cycle. Thus, there is one topic, environmental education, prescribed in the syllabus of environmental geography. Here, before beginning the chapter, we have to make a decision what to study under this head, environmental education. There may be two aspects. Number one, we can study the educations imparted directly and indirectly by the environmental factors. For example, in olden days, our saints used to live in environment. They were very close to environment, and the educational institutions, gurukuls, were also located in the vicinity of the environment. Rural people also used to live with environment, and that's why those days people learned a lot from the environment. Environment was a great teacher. Even today, we learn a lot from the environment. For example, when the trees, you take mango trees, bears the fruit, its branches are inclined. It tells us a lesson, a very valuable preaching, that if we get name, fame, money, or any of the earthly thing, we should bend down. We should not boast of it. In the same way, if there is some storm or cyclonic wind, the trees bend and protect them from the storms. This teaches us a lesson that if there is any type of disturbance, social storm, peril, we should bend and relax. There should be elasticity and flexibility in us, and thereby we can protect us. Thus, these are the educations or lessons imparted by the environment to the people. This is one aspect of environmental education. It is education given by the environment. But here our topic is environmental education. The second aspect of environmental education is to educate, to inform, to make aware the people about the environmental ingredients or factors. And there we have to focus mainly on the environmental resources. And the aim of environmental education is to make aware the people regarding the abiotic and biotic environment. In abiotic environment, there are different lithospheric, atmospheric, and hydrospheric variables, the knowledge of which to everybody is relevant and important. And the second aspect is biotic environment, wherein all the plants and animals and their value, nutrition value, medicinal value, should be known to each and every, because these are resources and their resource value. By environmental awareness, we can know their use, their utility, and their resource value. And thus, this knowledge may help people to use those abiotic and biotic valuable resources, and by use, if they are being polluted, degraded, the people may learn to conserve those resources, and at last, if some environmental resource is at the verge of extinction, certainly the people may learn, may be educated to protect that environmental resources. There are different types of valuable environmental resources. Some are renewable, like water, air, while some are non-renewable, means depletable. For example, the fossil fuel environmental resources. So, the people on this planet should be made aware of the nature of these resources, because only having the knowledge of these resources, their use, the people may follow this sustainable development idea. And sustainable development is very important, and it is the need of our, because whatsoever resource Mother Nature has given to us, it should be conserved and preserved for the coming generation. Thus, the need of our is to understand the meaning of environmental factors and use it, preserve it, because Mother Nature can nurture us, and at the same time, Mother Nature, if angry, can destroy us, damage us. That's why the knowledge of environment is must for us, because we have to pass our life in the lap of our benign Mother Nature. The next point is environmental education. What is education? Education means to impart knowledge by any means to all. This environmental education may be put in two groups, two categories. Number one is formal education, and number two is non-formal education. In formal education, we start from the pre-primary level to the highest PG level, research level, and institute study level. Before pre-primary, when child is in the lap of mother, that child is inclined towards the environment, especially biotic environment. That may be dog, that may be cow, and that child loves that dog, cow. And when the child is admitted in school at pre-primary level, that child learns the letters with the help of some animals or environmental biotic ingredients. For example, C for cow, E for element. That's why the environmental biotic factors help that child to keep the shape of the letter, maybe English, maybe Hindi, or other languages. At secondary and senior secondary level, when the student is in class 10th and 12th, certainly he is imparted deeper knowledge of environment, and environment studies involved there means he or she at this level is expected to know all the relations between the ingredients of environment. For example, at this level of deep knowledge or study, that student learns the relationship between the insulation and tree, how the insulation affects tree plant growth, and how plant affects that amount of insulation. This studies is knowledge in deep sense. For example, there is difference between general knowledge and general studies. In the same way, at this level, student understand the knowledge in depth, and there are some projects and competitions wherein the student has to prepare the relationship between the season and animals, relationship between the relief and vegetation. These project works student has to accomplish on the basis of survey in the field. And this type of course has been prescribed by the different boards like CBSE, UP, Maharashtra, West Bengal, etc. And all over world, all the governments have prescribed this in the courses of their country. Next point is at UG and PG level classes in universities, there is a compulsory paper, environmental studies, and somewhere it is of qualifying nature, and EVS means environmental sciences paper is there, but in some universities there is a paper disaster management is also deeply interrelated with the environment, because today environmental hazards and disasters are taking place. That's why at this highest level, students are expected to have the environmental education and how to implement it there for the welfare of environment, society. Students are expected to know it and take active part in the environmental and disaster management. Next point is, after PG, students are busy in research work. That's why at research level, at local or regional level, there are projects, and researchers are expected to apply this knowledge of environment with their subject. The aim of any research and the betterment of society is possible only on the basis of good environmental health. And today, University Grant Commission is awarding projects to universities on the basis of interdisciplinary approach. It means for the development and betterment of any tribal area, all the scientists, means economists, geographer, politicians, sociologists are combined together, and they are integrated to put such a proposal which are eco-friendly and which are for the sake of sustainable development of that region. So these are at national level, but at the same time, at international levels also, the world governments are imparting this type of formal and non-formal education. For example, efforts have been made by UNESCO on 4th November 1946 to impart the environmental education at world level. Likewise, NCERT, National Council of Educational Research Training, also has started in 1964 the Education Commission, wherein the environmental studies has been included and emphasized. Likewise, the Ministry of Environment of Forest, located at Ahmedabad, also has started the environmental education in 1984 in India, and this center is also imparting this environmental education, and researches are being conducted, and the knowledge of the environment is being enhanced and imparted. So these are the formal sector of spreading the environmental education. The second category of environmental education is non-formal. It means it is not classroom education. Rather, it is general education for making aware the general people about the environment, wherein first point is TV and channel telecast. In televisions through different channel like National Geography and Discovery, these channels show different aspects of environment, that is about the wild animals, natural forest and mountain, plateau, plain, ocean and other wild landscapes. And people watching this TV and different channels are aware of the environment and its conservation and resource value. Next point is radio transmission. For example, Akashvani India, Akashvani Allahabad imparts such lessons, teachings and informations to the people attending the radio programs. Next is print media. In print media, newspapers play very important role, and those publish important environmental incidents, factors and their discussions. Likewise, magazines and journals also publish the environmental essays and researches. In magazines, the topic are of different natures, means social environment, political environment, economic environment, while in journals, specific topic, suppose geographical environments, are mentioned. Thus, these newspapers, magazines and journals also spread the knowledge of environment to the society. Next point is lectures by specialists in conferences. At university, state and national level, a number of conferences are being held. For example, the Conference on Sustainable Development, Environmental Management, Climatic Change are being held, wherein specialists deliver talks, discussions are there, and findings are reached, which are sent to University Grant Commission, state governments, and those are being implemented and considered while preparing the policy and implementing these policies. Next point is lectures by specialists and expert officials in village community and tribal community. Our village people, especially the tribal people living in remote areas, are unaware of the environmental knowledge. That's why sometimes specialists and experts of the subject, environmental scientists, reach there and they tell them about the environmental resources, its conservation and management. Next point is adult education. Our governments have started adult education. Besides imparting literacy among them, the experts tell those rural and tribal people about the environmental resources, how to use it, how to conserve it. And the next point is crossroad play. In it, the school students as well as the rural students and people participate, and they tell the viewers, the audiences, that environment is of paramount significance, and it is environment that is of use for us as a resource, and at any cost, environmental resources should be conserved and preserved. Thus, this is about the environmental education, wherein first you should write down what is environment, what are environmental resources, how these are renewable and renewable, and how these should be used, conserved and preserved. And at local, regional, national and international level, how environmental education is being imparted at this formal and non-formal sectors.